I'm Emil Mosseri, and I scored The Last Black Man in San Francisco.
I always come back to the old house. What if it's empty? What if we just peeked inside?
We could throw parties. You could put on one of your plays. We could yell.
It is this house.
Our old house.
That's not your old house, and that's not your neighborhood.
You know, I was always in bands growing up as a kid, and then I also was interested in film music. I first fell in love with the form with Danny Elfman and Edward Scissorhands, you know. That score, I was about 16, that kind of blew my mind. The Dig, the band started, we were childhood friends growing up, and we moved to New York together, to the city together, and we put out our first record around 2010, and been on the road ever since, and we all moved together to Los Angeles. So the band had been living in New York for about 10 years, and we'd been on the road about half the year or more, but when I wasn't on the road, I was composing music for short films and for a few people, among them Terrence Nance. So I'd moved to Los Angeles right around the time that Terrence's show, Random Acts of Flyness, got picked up and was on the air. And I was, through mutual friends, I got connected to an agent that connected me to Joe. And then we hit the ground running on Last Black Man. It's an interesting transition going from playing music in a band to writing orchestral music for a film. It helps to stay busy and to do these things back to back so that you feel like your creative juices are always flowing and you're not getting rusty, but you also have the novelty of a completely new format and a completely new medium. I find that to be exciting and inspiring. When I first started talking to Joe about the score, he let me know that it was important for him to have the music feel not necessarily film music, that it could stand on its own as a work. When I first started composing music for this film, I wasn't scoring the picture, I was just writing music in the spirit of the film. And I think the first cue that really felt like we had it, or we had like the emotional core, the heart of the film, is the title track, that plays in the end of the film. It's the friendship theme with Jimmy and Mont, titled "The Last Black Man in San Francisco." When we found that, that was sort of one of the main touchstones of the score, and we could sort of build the rest around that. I always like to think of it as there being two sides of the score. There's the friendship theme, The Last Black Man in San Francisco. So the other side of the score is more regal and more brass heavy, that almost hints at the majestic tale of Jimmy being this deposed prince that has come back to reclaim his family throne. Well, the use of human voice in the score was a very important element, and something that Joe and I had talked about very early on in the process. And we didn't record a full choir or a big orchestra. We actually only used two vocalists, a female vocalist named Camila Gibson, who's incredible, and a baritone named Ralph Cato. And they both served the purpose of not only making the score feel more human, but also just because there's nothing more visceral than the human voice. Especially Ralph, his voice sort of being mixed in, blended into the tapestry of the film, almost was like a helped draw the line between Jimmy and his spiritual connection to the house. There were a few scenes that were particularly challenging for whatever reason. The one that comes to mind that's still haunting my dreams is a cue called "Whatever Gets You Through the Night." I think it was most challenging because it was in a pivotal scene that was very heavy on dialogue, and a scene about a realization and a revelation, and it was very tricky to sort of dance around delicately that dialogue and then have it land in the right place emotionally. But I think, you know, that's the fun part, is getting into the weeds and getting yourself in a hole and digging yourself out. Now, this was an incredibly collaborative effort between Joe and I, and he's brilliant musically and has all these great ideas, so it was fun to get into the weeds with him in a way that, that was so rewarding for both of us. It's such a personal story for Jimmy and for Joe that it was a great privilege and a responsibility to deliver something that did them right.